The dream is fading now, I'm staring at the door. I know it's over cause my feet have hit the cold floor. Check my reflection, I ain't feeling what I see. It's no...
What's popping, guys?
What's up, everybody?
What's up?
Hi!
Everybody
Rocky
say hi.
Action, baby. front double. I'll piss off for living.
Why is it me, Steve, and AJ we match? What?
That's because we're sexy. Nah, that's not a Christian like
word. Hey, we be crafty sisters, sexy.
Hey, we try to be sexy. That's all that matters. That's my goal.
I don't think this is what we're talking about. Anyway.
No.
All right, so... we're not Justin Timberlake over here.
What's up, viewers? Everyone needs to check in on this. You guys are going to get better. This is about progression and helping you guys out because we love you.
You're right, Maddie.
Plus, you guys help us. We get some help from you, too.
So. It is lame. All right, so this week, I'm actually live on Facebook right now, and we're recording for our YouTube episode series. You already know. We're talking about, last week we talked about leadership.
Yes.
And what it means to be a leader.
How that pertains to legacy.
So, the flip side of it, guys, what does it mean to be a servant? Ouch.
Okay, I'm just going to give one really quick. I know I'm not going to talk the whole time. I'll just start this out. Being a servant, I look at it from a biblical worldview, and I view it as being humble. When I see Christ, he washed the disciples' feet, and he was God incarnate. He was God in the flesh. So definitely being a servant entails being a humble person, which entails you being a person that thinks very low of themselves, but at the same time, that doesn't mean you can't be confident. So move on to Jay here.
Servant is basic. It's really simple. It's doing things you would not normally do for the benefit of others.
It's not about your credentials.
Right. So being a servant is not about us, right?
It's altruism.
So what's some daily things that we do? When we're, we work.
Yeah.
So each one of us works a job. Sometimes. And we have to be a servant, right?
Yeah.
Robert, what do you think?
Definitely. I mean, serving is basically having a humble attitude in order to better or meet the needs of somebody else and sacrificing your own needs in order so that their needs can be met.
Right.
It's a true act of love.
So yeah, there's that word sacrifice again.
Ouch, we don't like that one.
I don't like to sacrifice much in my life.
I'm gonna go act like I sacrifice all the time. I definitely don't like to sacrifice much.
What do you think, AJ?
You gotta be humble.
It also means I worked in a restaurant, and I do most of the hard suited cleaning jobs. So, but when I do my job, I'm going to probably do the best job in the world. Kind of like, I'm cleaning the toilet. That toilet don't mean the best toilet in the world. I'm definitely
clean that toilet.
It don't mean to be the cleanest toilet in the world. It don't be clean. My toilet don't be clean.
Especially mine.
Right. So even if you're cleaning toilets, we're talking about being the best servant we can be. What do we call that? Is that a sense of love, being a servant?
I think it definitely pertains to love. Because how can you be sacrificial and think of others as better than yourself without being loving? How can you be humble, which is sacrificial without being loving? I think there's a correlation there.
Yeah, I mean.
Another question to ask real quick is being a servant. Can it be a servant if it's wage driven? Is that really being a servant if you're gaining? Gaining a profit.
If you're gaining, I wouldn't define
gaining
it.
Gaining money. That's what I'm saying. What AJ was talking about his job. I mean, he could be a servant by going above and beyond what would be done.
That's what
I'm saying.
He's a servant because the normal standard for someone cleaning there probably isn't to clean crap off the toilets. They probably had him do that because he was willing to do that because he was so humble, which goes
to
him.
That's
not the normal standard to clean crap off the toilet.
Clean it just enough so no one will notice it.
So. Yes.
So,
that would not be being a servant, but what he's doing would be.
That's my fault.
So, we could say servanthood could be your attitude?
Yeah.
Doesn't involve attitude, I think?
I think it does because before you do something, isn't attitude a precursor to action? Our attitude, a lot of times, I think our attitudes, what we think about, how we dwell on things, dictate how we will perform in life. I'll give you an example real quick. I like working out. You guys see that flex? But If I have an attitude that is lazy and complacent and hesitant, am I going to be able to work out as hard as I can to build develop a good physique? No. But if I have an attitude of devotion and dedication and discipline and consistency, that's going to definitely affect how often I go to the gym, how hard I train, and the results that will entail.
Okay, so we're talking attitude as far as servanthood. So attitude, in other words, to be a good servant and to be love, your attitude has to be there. Hi, Mom. Anyway, so
Mom here. What's up, Mom? I love you.
Hi, Mom.
I'm gonna see you in a minute.
This is really good. Focused,
I'm sure our parents are watching. But anyway,
not mine.
No, not at all. So
they need some laughs. We've been serious the last 2 weeks.
Yeah, we've been serious, but we're gonna tackle some hard issues this week too. So as far as being a servant, our attitude has to be there. In other words, you know, we have to have an attitude, I think, of love in order to be a good servant. And I think personally, to serve is love. I mean, when you're serving somebody and your attitude's there and your heart's right, I mean, can we call that love? I mean, I think so.
Yeah.
I think I call that love.
Let's have Robert,
so much to give an opinion.
Yeah, being a servant is what love is. It's love is the definition of love is putting your needs, and kind of like the back burner of somebody else's needs.
Where do we get it from? Does love come from God or from our own intuition?
Oh, good question.
I think both.
But I think that a godly view is truthful, meaning that it's relevant. No matter, it's the most relevant view. So when I look at God and his definition of love, I look at Jesus. He loved us by dying on the cross for us, right? He was a servant in the sense that he died at a young age, and he died a terrible death that he did not have to, die, whatever. So at the same token, we look at that and we see that being a servant and love go hand in hand, you know what I mean, from God. God's idea of that is sacrifice, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So...
It's true.
But I will say with attitude, being a servant, also, you may have a bad attitude in serving when you go into it, but, like, regardless, if you cast what you feel, like, temporarily aside, that's being a servant. It's acting regardless of any kind of attitude you have at the current time.
So,
it's
yeah.
Following through with something that will help another.
So, does
prioritizing that over your own
feelings. Does servanthood involve killing our emotions, killing how we feel?
Yeah, for sure. Definitely.
You think?
I don't know. I guess I think for me, I think
that's
I think for me, servanthood and love would be controlling our emotions, right? Because if we let them get out of the control, then obviously sometimes we don't project love. Do I have that backwards?
But I think at the same time I disagree, because the Bible tells us Paul said he kills his flesh daily. Our emotions are part of our flesh, and being a servant would entail one to not abide by the flesh, but abide by some other source that is opposes the flesh. So at the same time, I think when we say that our emotions cause us to be servants, we would be abiding by the flesh, and the Bible tells us that we're not to do that. So I don't think it always works.
Yeah, I think being a servant, sometimes it'll be easy for you to do, and other times it'll be very difficult. It just depends. But overall, being a servant is something we all should strive to do, and it's... always a positive.
You got any live feeds here? I love you too. Someone said love you. Love isn't real.
Yeah, but can you be a servant without being a Christian though? Yes, you can.
Yeah, you can.
So that's why we said
okay, secular.
So should we relate?
Yeah, you can.
No, but from that standpoint, we can say that you can be a servant. Definitely, you can be a servant without.
You have to
being
be a
Christian.
No, I'm just kidding.
You can be loving. By being a Christian and by not being a Christian. But the real difference is, how do you know somebody's a Christian? By the way they love. How do you know Jesus by the way he... How do you know Jesus to be different?
What if they're just
by the way he loves?
What if they're just a good person?
That's why you have to love differently. You have to love more.
What if you love the same? One's a good person, one's a Christian. How? What's making it different?
What's making it different?
Yeah.
tackling some hard issues here.
I'm playing devil's advocate here just to get...
It also don't fit far with that. I mean, a person would not be a Christian and feel love, and you don't know if he's a Christian or not, but he'll be somebody right. love.
I mean,
but he probably won't be a Christian.
They will know. I would say this: Jesus preached to love your enemies. Is that a popular?
No.
A secular.
I agree. It will be way more common for Christians, I would say, to be a servant than the general population who are just good people. I'll put an air quote.
I mean, yeah, you can
change
your
heart. Christ does. So
you can be morally good, but that doesn't. Does that mean that you're, I guess, always acting in the Abba love?
We're more provoked to be servants.
I think it comes down to. Is he recording here? I think it also comes down to, as far as not being a Christian, checking your pride out the door, because when you don't have pride, it gives you more opportunity to serve other people. And I think, yes, you can definitely still do that, whether you're a Christian or not. That comes from what you value. Do you value yourself more than others, or do you value others more than yourself? And you can definitely value others more than yourself without having Christ inside your heart. It could be how you're brought up. It could be your insecurity causing you to not think highly of yourself to love others more. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of different factors in that. So.
Right. So we're tackling a lot of hard issues this week. And for those of you watching on Facebook and YouTube, if you have questions or would like to share something that maybe happened to you this week, we would love to answer them. So if you're watching this right now, or if you're on Facebook or, you know, YouTube, whatever, and you just have something you want to post or something's on your heart, we'll be happy to answer questions. We are tackling a lot of hard issues.
Let me ask another question for anyone here.
Go ahead.
What do you think, how does someone evolve into a servant? I think that's a good question to ask.
Wow, that's good.
So what are the steps you need to take?
Well, it starts with making... Here you go. I need to be sacrificial. I'm sitting there talking to Paul.
You're good, man. You're good. You have a.
You're about as sacrificial as a buffet right now.
Feed him more.
Feed him more. The good thing, the really good thing I like about Steve is he always has an opinion, but he always has a really educated opinion. So I enjoy him, but. I'm sorry, what was your question again? Dude, I'm sorry, I was getting lost.
How do you become
a
servant?
How do you become a servant? So what are the steps we need to take?
I think you honestly need to value other people's needs as more than your own.
Right.
And the one thing I would say too, Steve talked about emotions. This is a question for the audience. Do you control your emotions? Or do your emotions control you?
Nice. That's a good one. That's a real good one. I mean,
because if your emotions are fleeting, God's principles are everlasting.
That's good.
And what does He call us to do? He calls us to be servants. He sent His Son Jesus, because Jesus was the antithesis of what a servant should be.
Yeah. Right.
Sorry for the big word. That's just.
I thought that big word was sexy. Keep going.
I know, right?
But jeez, I'm liking. I'm learning.
The soul.
Jesus because he needed to make Jesus to be an example of how to be a servant.
Yes.
Right.
And so because being a servant, you're showing love. And that's exactly why Jesus was sent on this earth, is to be love in a world full of hate.
I think you just hit on it, man. I'm going to take this real short, okay? It just entails just loving more, okay? So I think you can't have servanthood without love, and you can't have love without servanthood, vice versa. So then the question comes about, what is love? And it just comes about thinking of others more so than yourself. Love is sacrifice to me. I get that from a biblical worldview. So I just want to encourage you guys just to start loving more and truly loving. Don't base how you treat others based off how you feel. Don't base your goals in life based off what makes you better. Start thinking about other people, how they can progress, how they can change and live a transformed life that's better than the one they're living currently. So
now, okay, so Jay hit on it in the beginning. This is going to be the hard part, especially for you watching at home. You hit on it in the beginning. So love and servanthood, with respect, we talked about relationships and Valentine's Day as well. Should we expect it back? Is that why we do it?
No.
Okay. Should we know? But do we at times? Yes. You know, I scratch your back, you scratch mine. That's sometimes how we approach servanthood. But I think with being a servant, the nature of it, if you're doing it for something at the end of it, like to receive something back, then you're not. It's not truly servanthood.
Well, that's like
could we say the same thing about love?
Yes.
But I think it's just with servanthood. So,
we need to love despite having a compensation in return. Yes. Absolutely.
So yeah, so no matter real love, guys, is like loving somebody without expecting that in return.
Love without expectation.
Right. So I think servanthood could go along with the same way. You know, when we choose to be a servant, when you, Robert, when you, Jay, when you, Steve, when me, and you, AJ, we all choose to be a servant. I think when we choose the life of a servanthood, it's one of the hardest lives you can live. Because when we're being a servant or when we're loving, we're not supposed to expect anything in return. We do it because we want to. Right?
Yeah.
So in the same way, when Robert, you were talking about Jesus did it because he wanted to, not because he expected anything from us.
Yeah, there's no reciprocity.
Ooh, wait here. Ooh. So you're saying being a servant is hard, but Jesus calls us all to be a servant. Ooh. So does that mean that being a Christian is hard?
Uh-oh.
Nice.
A little bit. Whoa.
Okay. I want to dive into something really quick here, okay? We said that as servants, we're not expecting compensation in return, okay? But here's the thing, though. Someone can only give so much. Yes, I said that. I am not God incarnate right here where I can just give. Hey, someone slaps me in the face, I forgive you. Someone slaps me in the face again, I forgive you. Someone steals my wallet, I forgive you.
Right.
So at the same token, we need to be encouraging those people that are giving to other people and are sacrificing more so than the average person. So I just want to encourage you guys, for those people to be servants continuously, you need to encourage them.
Build up those that are serving.
Yes. Okay. Because they're giving so much. You know what I mean?
It's like taking a candle and touching another candle to make a bigger flame.
Yes, exactly.
It's like you're helping each other.
And with that, we can have a more positive effect, right?
Yeah. When it's also, it sounds wrong what I'm about to say. It's if you're preaching to somebody who is not receptive to the gospel at all, how long do you continue that before you realize, is this really a waste of my time? Or would you rather spend your time to somebody who is really going to be receptive to it? I mean,
and that's very good. I understand that most of us aren't theologians here or people that are obviously practicing diligently the concepts of God. But what he's basically saying is, would you repeat what you just said again real quick?
Do we focus most of our time on people who are not going to be receptive to the gospel versus people that are?
Okay, so basically just use your time wisely, guys, whatever you guys are doing. So if you only have so much time in a day, so you want to make sure that you're efficient in how you use your time. Because if I have 2 hours to spend with somebody that's going to be unproductive to be around, I should not spend the time with them. Or I should use that time to spend time around with people that are going to change and grow and willing to try to succeed in life.
So in the same fact that we can be a servant without expecting return, but we want to be wise into who we are a servant to.
You want to make the most efficient and best difference.
Right.
And I think to Robert's point too, like, we don't want to give up on people immediately, but we want to present them God and then let God work on their heart. We can't expect them to become a super Christian in 1 month after confessing to Christ. Like, we have to let God work on them, and it takes time and patience.
Okay, and even, I'm going to challenge you guys right now. So even from let's say we're not witnessing, say that we're just being a servant. I mean, we can have a total impact in the way that we love people just by being a servant. So in fact, we don't even have to say anything. We can just do. So when we were talking about action, speak louder than words, right?
Definitely. I think that's true. So some people aren't going to be as, you know, they don't want to talk as much as others and whatnot. So don't get down on yourself if you don't talk a lot or if you're not evangelizing a lot or talking all the time. Just be a role model by your actions and how you live and being sacrificial and stuff like that.
Why that's key? Your actions will eventually give you a platform of who to speak to. But I mean, if you always live your life by a servant attitude, it gives you that opportunity to speak into somebody's life, because you've been, you're basically building yourself a credibility. You're giving yourself a voice by not having a voice, and by just grinding and serving, and therefore people are going to value your opinion more, because they understand it's not about talk, you're about action, and that'll give you a more fulfilling voice, and people will take heed of that more.
Right.
That's good too. Yeah, good way to look at it.
Actions will give you.
Is
the
there
voice.
Any other?
I like. Okay, so we have Shay on here. If they aren't receptive to the gospel, we should not call them hopeless, but lean to speak their lingo and lean what way would be most effective. Everyone has a different perspective system. Oh, you know what? Maybe we the next week or two we should go into language.
Hey, that'd be cool.
I think that's very good. And you know, honestly, yeah, Shay, that is key. Language is very key into how receptive people are. Because maybe we're a servant to somebody who's not receptive to what we're doing. We're just trying to help them. But they don't really get it. They don't understand it. Maybe they woke up on the wrong side of the bed that day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? So maybe we should hit the heart issue of, okay, so what are they going through? Maybe we should put ourselves in their shoes.
Empathy, yeah.
Well, in regards to, thank you for your question, Shay. I didn't mean to kind of frame that as in, we're basically having these, it's, the person is not hopeless. I was more so using it in a frame of witnessing,
right.
Trying to make that now serving. I don't really honestly serving. I'm gonna serve to whoever if they're not really receptive or not, because
yeah.
By their receptiveness is not based on that.
Yeah, servanthood implies there's no bias to servanthood.
Yeah.
All right, Shay. Definitely, I agree with your bottom comment. Let's just read it here. Most tones actions speak louder. Our responsibility is not to change people; it's our responsibility to love them and keep our arms open. That goes with Ezekiel 3:18. So I definitely agree with that. But at the same, so God holds us responsible for the words we say and how we carry ourselves around those people that are maybe not Christians. He doesn't leave us responsible for the things that those people do, whether or not they apply what we say or whatnot. So He just holds us accountable for what we do tell them. So I definitely do agree with that. And as far as love goes, though, love is not always about comfort and ease. It's about challengement. It's about trying to get them to grow as a person, as a Christian in life.
It prioritizes truth over family.
Yes, love is not acceptance. As a nation in America today, that's the message that's going across. Love is acceptance. Love
tolerance.
Love has no. You can't take a stand against someone if you love them.
Right.
You
know? I mean, I'm not going to have the same opinion as you.
We need to agree to disagree in regards to that. So.
Yeah, and I'm not going to have the same opinion as AJ or Jay.
You love them more, but you don't want to be a little to bring you down on your Christianity.
That's a good point.
Yeah, because
right.
You want to hold them down on the
board. But at the same time, we want to speak into others' lives that aren't yet acknowledging Christ in their life. So it's a really hard balance as a Christian.
It's a happy medium.
It really is.
It's a tough medium.
It really is,
because I was at Steve's church this Sunday night, and we watched a really good video about this guy talking about love. One of the things that really hit home is, love without change is tolerance. I thought that was so powerful because, like, say, if I love Jay, do I want him to stay the same or get worse? Absolutely not. I want to see Jay do the best he possibly can for me to speak into his life and encourage him.
So, well, we can have enemies if we choose to love somebody because we're challenging them to change their lives.
So, with what you're saying, tolerance is then a lack of love. To just tolerate.
Yes, absolutely.
Oh, yes.
Tolerance definitely is a lack of love.
Ouch,
America. I know that hurt American society. That brings good into their lives. And the approach of our relationships with them, with humility and respect. It's not a lack of love. It's peaceful existence with each other. You don't know that you are right. To assume that you know how to make someone's life better isn't humility. It's arrogance. Okay, the issue I have with this, though, is if I don't know what is right, how do I ever take a stand for what I believe? As a person, I'm not going to live my life without a purpose. I'm going to make sure that I do have beliefs. And yes, I'm going to take a stand for them, and that might upset people. Another thing you said, tolerance is respect. I don't think tolerance is just respect. I think tolerance is me agreeing with them. Because when somebody asks me a question and I don't respond back, or, you know what I mean, or they make a statement, I don't respond back. If, by me not saying nothing at all, I am basically essentially agreeing with them. because I have nothing
wrong with it. He's also labeling a strong body as arrogant. That's not necessarily true.
So I disagree with that, but good way of thinking. I see what you're saying. I don't agree, but love the question. Thank you for asking that question.
We appreciate it, Colby, for real.
No, go ahead. What were you saying?
One of the first questions, he said, when somebody is trying to better life, do he have to disagree or not agree? But on the bad part about that is, with somebody trying to better life in the wrong way, you don't say nothing, that guy might ruin his totally kill his life.
Exactly.
It's true.
Like we said, the Bible's an offense. It disavows other beliefs. So yes. by inherently believing the Bible, you're interpreting that as arrogant by me not accepting a universal thought system of everyone else. Whereas we interpret it as holding the truth because we've accepted Christ. We have one view and you have another there. It doesn't necessarily mean we're arrogant in our view.
Yeah.
It's a spirit about what you carry the view.
Yeah, that's a really good point.
And also, is the gospel peaceful to all those who don't believe? Of course, it could be, because you could see Jesus as a non-violent kind of protest. But at the same time, like we said, the gospel is very offensive. And a lot of people will think that's not very peaceful, because you're saying that Jesus is the only way to heaven. Jesus is the only way to live your life. Now, that means you're saying every other religion is wrong. Every other way to live your life is wrong. That's not really peaceful.
I'm going
to
go ahead and do a Winston Churchill quote real quick, guys. He said, "So you stand for something, ... That means you have enemies, all right? I'm going to live my life with a purpose, which entails that I take a stand for something. How can I live a purposeful life without standing for anything?"
I think it
contradicts the concept of purpose. That has how God made us, because he made us in his own image. And like I said, my purpose is the Bible. If you don't respect that, that's fine. I will always stand for that. But I love you guys. Keep asking questions.
That's a good question. We do.
I really appreciate the question.
And from a non-religious standpoint, okay, if I'm tolerant of somebody and I'm silent, and maybe what they're doing is wrong, okay? I'm silent, I'm just as guilty.
In other words,
I'm not arrogant because I'm telling this person, okay, maybe that's not the right thing to do. But I'm trying to help them. I'm trying to be their best friend. You know, if I'm tolerant and silent just because they have a different belief, then I'm not really being a good friend, am I? We're supposed to disagree anyway.
That's why it's called a dialogue.
But that's why we listen to each other.
Yeah.
But you should be able to share your belief without causing a bunch of conflict. If I have to worry about whether or not I offend somebody because they're going to get so mad at me because we disagree, that's that person's issue. That's where we all stand wrong as a culture, is we can't accept diversity. We can't accept things that don't go our way.
Political correctness is not healthy.
Yes.
Absolutely. Political correctness is definitely not healthy.
Yes.
I think that doesn't mean
to the other end where you literally hate on everyone who doesn't agree.
And I understand.
There's a limit to that.
We're more conservative. I know that, guys. But like I said, we stand for something. We're trying to encourage you guys. Keep asking the questions. We want to answer them objectively without being biased. So.
Yeah. And, you know, let's see. There are diverse opinions.
Good answer, man.
It's considered truth. Yeah, okay, Shay, good point. Thank you. All right. Shay says, there are multiple diverse opinions about what is considered truth. There are many sides to a diamond.
In other words,
I won't learn anything unless I learn somebody else's opinion.
Yes.
I mean, we have to be helpful with each other. And me standing for what I believe in may help them with something. I don't know. But if I don't say it at all, then I can't help them.
Absolutely.
Same thing with me. If I'm struggling with something that I don't like and somebody says something that's true and I need to hear it, if they don't say it, then I can't improve.
Tolerance and passiveness go hand in hand. Improvement. Passiveness does not cause improvement.
Who are you going to adult to anyway? So. You don't say nothing.
Yeah.
You ain't got a friend that don't say nothing. Who
I mean, what is the world without being a best friend to each other? We're silent.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, like, and that doesn't help.
Let me tell you this really quick. Just put this camera on me. What would the world be like without laws? What would the world be like without laws? Speed limit laws. Morality laws. Okay? The world would be chaotic.
You knew it was going to happen eventually.
Listen, I know, right?
Listen, the world would be chaotic without laws. That means that we have to have some type of structure, stance towards something, so that the world can operate effectively. It can operate at a moral way. So just remember that you have to take a stance for something for morality, for structure, and all these things to occur.
If not,
otherwise the world will be chaotic.
If not, crazy. Those stance isn't a valid or productive stance.
If not anything, stand for something. Do it for yourself, please. I mean, you cannot improve our society. You cannot improve their environment. You can't even improve your friends if you don't stand for something. If you're silent about what you believe in, then you're not helping anybody.
You're just allowing the world to take you.
Yeah, I mean, you're just waiting to, like, pretty much keel over. So, all right, so all this back to servant and in love. And, all right. And we kind of wrapped around
full circle.
I've sailed
the Titanic, man, by the time you go back to servant.
Yeah. So, servant and in love. I mean, it involves doing things maybe we don't want to do, not for the benefit of ourselves, but putting others first, right, guys?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So, I mean, what we want our viewers at home, really, what we want you guys to take is, you know, if you have a different opinion than us, that's fine, okay?
Express it.
We want to hear it. We want to hear it. We're not going to get offended. We don't hate you. Like, it's not about that. It's about improving each other.
We might not like it, but...
Unless I mean, even if we don't like it, we're going to listen to it.
I mean, unless you're Golden State fans, then
Shay,
we don't
I love your question. Shay, I love your expressions.
Shay,
I love your viewpoints.
Shay, Colby, thank you.
Colby, yes,
yeah,
you're
really, everybody,
really
everybody.
Questions.
Colby, I love your views as well.
Yeah, I mean, and we have to have these viewpoints. What do you think we should get into next week, guys?
Oh boy, this
is language.
So
language.
That one's
cool.
Gonna be a tough one.
So language. Okay, so. I actually like that one because should
Christians speak a certain way?
I feel like this is going
to
be
should we judge others?
Should we
as Christians?
Yeah, should we judge others? Should we voice our opinion? Should we not? Or in language and lingo, should we learn how to communicate with people?
Yes. So if somebody's like somebody comes from
this
a different
is for next week.
Somebody comes from a different culture. Do I have some type of conformity to their culture so that I can develop a relationship with them? Once again, if someone's from a different culture than me, do I conform to their culture some way, shape, or form so I can develop a relationship and then impact their life? Because you have to have a relationship before you do that. So
I don't know. We should get into that. That's going to be a hard subject, and I think there's going to be some. Opinions on that. There's going to be a lot of questions on that. So
let's go.
Yeah. So guys, we thank you for tuning in with us. Again, if you want to see this again, this will be on YouTube as well. I'm going to have the edited version on YouTube. And yeah, good stuff, guys. So
let's give some, we gave the fans some shouts and feedback. There's going to be more structure next week too. I know we said 9:30. We started about 9:40 today. We apologize for that. We are going to try to make it a goal to start at the set time that we schedule, whether it's on Facebook or wherever, social media, wherever it's at. So we're sorry about that. And keep posting your viewpoints. And if you don't post them, guys, we're never going to be able to help you. You know, so we can only
And you're
help
never
you.
Going to be able to help us.
Yeah, so we need
please.
Help too. So please post.
So if you guys have opinions and viewpoints on this, please, we would love to hear them. If you have any questions about it, let us know. Again, servanthood is love, and love is servanthood. We
Amen.
Cannot say this so many times.
Preach it, brother.
But yeah, so we will see you guys next week. We're going to be talking about language and lingo in conversation and how we communicate with other people, maybe even if they don't speak our language.
How we affirm to other people.
Yeah, and how do we talk to people like that, and how do we, you know, if somebody...
Telephone and narrating.
Yeah. And that goes along with how to be diverse.
Yes.
So
that's very
good. So this is gonna be some good stuff. Next week also I'm going to have us on hopefully on YouTube live as well. So stay tuned and thank you. Thank you for everything. Thank you, Colby. Thank you, Shay.
And I want to see more viewers next week, guys. Invite your friends, Colby, Shay, whoever else posted, invite your friends to watch this. This is a different We all have opinions here, but these are educated opinions. These are good opinions. We are not people that base our opinions off our own intuition, but off of principles and truths that we are very confident in. So.
Or experiences that we've learned.
Yes.
So, guys, thank you again. And, okay, so next week, the convo, it's going to be either Wednesday or Thursday. Probably I'll get the YouTube up Thursday. We'll probably do another one. What, Wednesday?
Yeah, let's go.
Probably Wednesday next week. So hope to see you guys again. Thank you. Love you guys. And have a good night.